In this video, we will discuss how to identify an appropriate measurement system that is aligned to the behavior dimension of interest used in evaluating whether a functional assessments-based intervention is effective. The reasons we collect behavioral data is to accurately measure behavioral performance, which is necessary for many reasons, including accurately measuring baseline levels of behavior, as well as objectively determining effectiveness of any intervention effort. We will use single case design, which we will discuss more thoroughly in the video on step 5, testing the intervention. Behavior has several different dimensions. It is necessary to first identify the behavior dimension that is of interest before you can select an appropriate measurement system. Behavior has at least 6 dimensions. These are frequency or rate, duration, latency, topography, locus, and force. Frequency refers to the number of responses in which the behavior occurred. Think count. Frequency is the dimension of interest when you want to know how many times something occurs, such as number of times a student answers a question correctly. Whereas rate refers to a ratio of count per observation time and is calculated by dividing the number of responses by the total observation time. So if I was interested in knowing the rate of correct responding, I would count the number of correct answers on a student's math facts sheet and divide that number by the time it took that student to complete. So a count of 9 correct answers during a 10-minute work block would equal to a rate of about 0.90 per minute. A second possible dimension is duration, or how long a behavior lasts. Duration is a good dimension of interest when measuring a behavior that a person is engaging in for too long or for too short of a time. For duration, you can measure the total duration of an entire observation session. For example, the student was out of his seat for 43 minutes in a 60-minute window, or duration per occurrence, such as the student was out of his seat for an average of 3.07 times per minute over 14 instances. A third possible dimension, latency, refers to the amount of time it took for a behavior to occur or be initiated. Latency is a good dimension when you're interested in the length of time between when a behavior is requested, stimulus, and when it actually begins, response. For example, wanting to know how long it takes the student to begin writing after the teacher explains the writing task and asks the students to begin. A fourth possible dimension, topography, refers to what a behavior looks like, or more specifically, its shape and form. For example, you may be interested in the letter writing skills of a student's cursive, or form of one's bat swing. A fifth possible dimension, locus, refers to where the behavior occurs, that is, its location or context. So this might be of interest when you want to know where the behavior is or is not occurring. For example, does the child eat in the cafeteria, in the hallway, or on the playground? A final dimension, force, refers to the strength or intensity of the behavior. For example, does the child scream or speak softly? More specifically, do the child speak loudly enough to be heard from a distance of 5 feet? 20 feet? What about from across the playground? Once the behavior dimension has been identified, it is important to select a measurement system that is well aligned to its dimension. To begin this selection process, you must first ask yourself, does the performance of the behavior take about the same length of time as every other time? If so, the behavior is uniform. Examples of uniform behavior include talking out of turn, cussing, and swearing. Non-uniform behaviors, on the other hand, refers to behaviors that vary in length each time. Examples of non-uniform behaviors include being off task or wandering around the room. This information is helpful as measurement systems are derived between two groups, event-based and time-based. Event-based measurement systems tend to be well aligned for measuring uniform behaviors and include gathering permanent products, frequency recording, where the count, the number of times the behavior was observed in a session, and convert to rate when possible, or rating the intensity or magnitude in which a behavior was performed. Time-based measurement systems tend to be well aligned for measuring non-uniform behaviors, such as duration or latency recording, interval recording, or time sampling. Interval recording and momentary time sampling are flexible and provide useful data. Across these systems, an observation period is divided into equal intervals, and observations are recorded for each interval. In partial interval recording, a behavior is marked for occurring in each interval if the behavior occurred at all at any time point during that interval. Whereas in whole interval recording, a behavior is marked for occurring in the interval if the behavior occurred during the entire length of that interval. For example, if I was observing for 15 minutes and each interval lasted 30 seconds, and in the second interval, I observe the behavior of interest for only 5 seconds, I'd indicate no occurrence of that behavior for that whole interval. Whereas in partial interval recording, I would have, as the student demonstrated the behavior of interest partially during that interval. Momentary time sampling, on the other hand, is a recording system where you record whether the behavior is occurring at the moment that each interval ended. In a 15-minute observation using a 1-minute interval, I would record whether the behavior was occurring at the end of each 1-minute interval. There are a number of devices that could be worn at the waist or wrist and apps available to assist you in interval recording, such as these systems described. Across interval recording and momentary time sampling systems, data are most often reported as percentage of total intervals in which the target behavior was scored as occurring. Partial interval recording has a tendency to overestimate behavior, so you may consider this system for behaviors you want to decrease, such as off-task. Whole interval recording has a tendency to underestimate and should be considered for behaviors you want to see increase, such as academic engagement time. It is important to consider your goal of the behavior you want measuring. Is your goal to increase or decrease the behavior? The answer to this question will inform your selection of the appropriate measurement system. The topics in this video offer a very brief introduction to behavior dimensions and some measurement systems. For more in-depth coverage, you may read Applied Behavior Analysis, 2nd edition, by Cooper, Urin, and Heuer, 2007, and Functional Behavioral Assessment and Function-Based Intervention, an Effective Practical Approach, by Ombright, Farrow, Leopsin, and Lane, 2007. You may also look at examples available at the CI3T website and IR Center website, which is headquartered at Vanderbilt University in Nashville and Claremont Graduate University in Claremont, California.